This conference will now be recorded.
All right. Good morning, good evening, wherever you are. Welcome to the session. So it's a new year, new possibilities. Let's see what we can do together here. Well, this is my agenda. I'm going to talk about what's happening around us, right? Well, a big change is happening, change at a great speed, and we need to catch that speed. In fact, to be ahead of the others and to have a demanding package, to have not to have the rotational shifts, maybe to work at your convenience, to get work from homes, to get all other leisures and luxuries at workplace, you need to multiply the speed that things are happening today so that you'll be ahead of what's happening. That probably helps you in what you're looking for. And then to talk about who is driving this change, is there something kind of a plan thing that is happening? Who is doing, for what purpose? Is that good or bad? Right? We'll talk about it, and then we'll take you to Azure 533 or Azure administration technical role, like what technical topics are covered in that certification. In fact, that certification is being discontinued or deprecated from 31st December 2018. So they plan to have two other certifications, that is AZ-100 and AZ-101. So we'll talk about it and what should be your learning path, what is mentioned in the blueprint, all of that stuff, right? So I know that what you guys must be thinking, like, Venkat, can you tell me a little bit about yourself, right? Well, of course, guys, myself, Venkat Kurela. My full name is Venkat Ramaya Kurela. I really love teaching. It's been more than 7 years or so. I've been delivering trainings at different stages. For the past 2.5 years, I'm working as certified. I mean, I'm working with authorized training partners to deliver corporate trainings. The official trainings I'm talking about into Azure, AWS, Google Cloud area. And outside of that, I deliver my freelancing trainings, like one that you are attending now. And I also work with clients to understand their requirement, design, implement, support, and migrate workloads into different other cloud platforms. Overall, I have some 13 years of IT experience. I worked in all verticals of IT, like into the server team, networking, storage, monitoring, and into the virtualization. So pretty much I have some 14 different certifications in different areas, and I am an Azure certified professional too, right? Then to talk about the agenda, that is what is happening around us. I know that you guys, some of you guys must be experienced, but maybe give me initial 10-15 minutes of time so that I'll make you understand what actually happening around us, and then why you see very less number of opportunities in the common roles, like maybe in server admin, Linux admin, Windows admin, network admin, storage admin, database administrator, middleware, ERP tools, maybe normal big data, on-premises big data things, right? Why a lot of politics happening nowadays, off late you see in any organization, the level of games that are happening nowadays is like changed like anything, because everybody feels that heat of the job security issue, right? Why is that happening? One thing common across all the companies. So we'll help you understand that part. Well, around us, a big change is happening. Okay, a big change. You talk to anybody, there is a change, and the change is the cloud. Well, you can ask me, Venkat, well, I know a friend of mine working in a machine learning area, but definitely cloud is not changed there. It's machine learning. Well, I know another friend of mine, he's working in big data analytics. He's getting a good package, but the change in that area is not cloud. It's the analytics, big data, or data science. I know another friend of mine who's working in DevOps. He's also earning good money. There, the change is not cloud. But how can you generalize saying cloud is a change? Change that is the big change. Well, if you observe, you ask anybody, DevOps that you're talking about, where is it implemented, where it is being implemented. If you understand DevOps, well, it is going to be altogether a different discussion, but a high level, DevOps is about automating things that you do normally or manually. It's about build automation. It's about CI/CD, continuous integration and continuous delivery, right? So build automation, where are you automating the builds? Where are you automating the deployments, right? If you have infrastructure on-premises, the physical servers, you will be automating them. If you have virtualization on-premises, you'll be automating them. But things are in the cloud. You talk to any company, it is a startup, mid-level, or a multinational company, at least some portion of their infrastructure in the cloud. And everybody's focus going forward will be cloud. Well, of course, I'll tell you why. You do not have to believe me that things are going into the cloud, but I'll give you a technical justification on why it is. Okay, but now, in the context of the discussion, well, the DevOps is in the cloud. That's only when, if you learn DevOps in the cloud, then only your career will be long-lasting. If you happen to learn DevOps on-premises, well, nobody is having the on-premises data centers in the first place. Then who's interested in hiring somebody who's expert in DevOps on-premises? Then machine learning. Machine learning, any application that you're hosting that is of a machine learning, right? You see where it is being hosted, in the cloud. You talk about big data, analytics, data science, where it is being hosted. Even Apache, which is a Hadoop big data clusters, are also being deployed into the cloud, and we call them as EMR clusters, Elastic MapReduce, or a data lake in Azure cloud, right? So, and maybe you talk about any other application. It could be a e-commerce application. It could be a simple blog or a website or anything, right? It is being implemented in the cloud. That's the reason today I wanted to generalize that a big change that is happening around is the cloud. Okay. So, what is this cloud, Venkat? Right. Well, the cloud is delivering IT services over the internet technologies in pay-as-you-go, on-demand, self-service way is called the cloud. Come on, hold on a while. I don't understand what it is. A book definition, I can Google it, right? What is a cloud? I Google it, I got this definition. But what it actually means? It means the big companies like Google, Amazon, Microsoft says that we deliver the data center or the IT services, that is servers, networking, storage, database, big data, analytics, machine learning, platform as a service offerings, software as a service offerings, mobile application development, the directory services like Active Directory or LDAP, the networking services like your switches, routers, everything is delivered over the internet, right? They say, one second. They say, well, buddies, why would you invest a huge amount of money in setting up the data centers with servers, network, and all other resources? Instead, you being a customer, connected to our data centers over the internet and make use of these services, any individual or a combination of any service, right? You just need a server? Well, happy. Come and use a server from us. You need a server storage? Well, use it. Use the combination of it. You need a server storage and database? Well, use it. Or database alone? Use it. So, cloud computing is delivering IT services. I am saying, remember, information technology services. It could be a software. It could be a application. It could be a server, it could be a piece of storage, a database, anything is delivered over the internet technologies to the customers is called the cloud computing. Of course, there is a lot that we need to discuss in cloud computing area, like the delivery models, like the platform as a service, software as a service, infrastructure as a service. Then the deployment models like the private cloud, public cloud, hybrid cloud, community cloud, right? And then the essential qualities of the cloud computing, like on-demand, pay-as-you-go, self-service, rapid elasticity, and then broad network access. Well, that's a different discussion altogether. Those who are interested, there is a YouTube channel of mine. You see a one-hour video about the cloud computing fundamentals. So search for a name called Venkat Kurela and you'll find it. But then in the interest of today's topic, right, cloud is a big change that every company is moving to it. And to understand the cloud, well, it is nothing but delivering IT services over the internet to the customers, right? So then what's happening around? Again, the same question. But the answer is change at a great speed, right? Change at a great speed. If you see a couple of years back, maybe early 2010, 11, I was working in Mumbai for HP. I was the SME for 22 accounts, BOB, Andhra Bank, Hutchison 3 Global Services. Now is taken by Tech Mahindra, called as Tech Mahindra Business Services. So there are 22 different accounts handled by HP. I mean, I was the SME for those 22 accounts in Western region of Mumbai. So then I was like working with pretty much every IT manager and to convince them to virtualize their Exchange, to virtualize their SQL databases, to virtualize their Oracle databases, and to virtualize their web servers. I'm not a product seller of VMware virtualization, but being a technology expert, I was giving the suggestions, making numerous presentations to help them understand in their given scenario how virtualization would help them in terms of the backups, in terms of the availability, the capital expense and the operating expenses. Well, then they were not ready with the wrong perception that virtualization will degrade the performance. Virtualization is not for the mission critical or real-time applications. But then change is inevitable. You see today, maybe until 2015, every organization is having the virtualization in place. And you see today, we have reached the next level, that is cloud computing. And if you follow the news, 2012 or 2011, the CEO of Oracle has to make a statement, cloud computing for customer-sensitive information is always a dream. It's never going to happen. By year 2014, just in 2 years, that they are the leaders in that space that he commented in. They have taken over the Salesforce. Now it has become Oracle's product. In the ERP space, that they are the leaders. Right? That's how the things have changed. And today you see, things are changing even faster. Why? Right? Why things are changing at a great speed? Why? Because you see a number, it's nice, good color, right? What is the relevance of it, Venkat? Well, relevance is a lot of savings that everybody posting. Oracle says, I mean, let's say the IBM says, well, we have opted to the cloud computing and we have saved this amount of money. TCS says that we've also opted to the cloud and we have saved, you know, even a bigger number. Infosys says we've opted to the cloud and we have saved even bigger number. So everybody is posting their numbers saying X plus 2, X plus 10, X plus 100, X plus 1000, the savings. So as everybody is posting the bigger numbers, the more companies are going for it. So it's like the more customers. As the more customers are going and everybody is saying it is success. Everybody is saying it is success. Right? So when you see the numbers of that big companies are in good number going to the cloud, that too, companies in different industries, you see, I'm not sure if you guys are aware that the HDFC, now they're running their applications in cloud, AWS cloud. You talk about the banking companies, you talk about government organizations, you talk about educational institutions, healthcare organizations, the normal IT companies, right? Pretty much everybody in all the industries opting to the cloud, and they are saying that we have saved the money, we have saved the time, we have You know, and it is all success. It is more agile, more durable, or maybe you say more time saving in the cloud. So it's 100% success everybody is reporting. Then people are what? Jumping to the cloud. But then Venkat, is that something that they're posting or it is true? It is true. Yes. It is true. Can you explain me how a cloud computing is saving money, giving you more security, giving you more durability, right? Saving a lot of time. How? Right? Well, it eliminates upfront cost. How? Let me ask you a question. If you are to buy a laptop, what would you do? You decide on a configuration. Maybe two CPUs, 8 gigs of RAM, or 16 GB of RAM. And you go to a shop. He says a price, let's say 1 lakh rupees. Microsoft Surface Pro or any other HP laptop, you see the high-end one, a minimum of 1 lakh. You buy it, right? So if you need a computer, you need a good configured laptop, good-looking, highly configured, lightweight, easy to carry, best performing, right? 1 lakh. You have to spend that 1 lakh rupee. There is no other way. And if the organizations have to have a server in place, right? Even now you can get off. I mean, once you are off of the presentation, off of the session, you can go to any official website, maybe from Dell or IBM, HP or Cisco, any other hardware selling company website you see. A server, an entry-level server will cost you approximately 10 lakh rupees. Entry-level server, a basic server. And if you see a high-end server, no surprise, if you see a real-time components and everything, you will see a server of at least 1 crore rupees. Okay. Let's take the normal numbers. Don't be fancy. Let's take 20 lakh rupees a server. Okay. Now, if you have to build a data center of 100 servers, what happens? 100 into 20 lakhs. Just the servers. And then what you need to buy? Operating system licenses. And then what you need to buy? The application licenses. And then what you need to buy? The application support. What you need to buy? The operating system support. What you need to buy? The hardware support. And then what you need to do? Hire all the verticals of teams like server team, network team, storage team, testing team, software development team, right? And then what you need to do? Managers for all the verticals, manager, senior manager, CIO, CTO, director, blah, blah, blah. Imagine how much of cost it is going to be. Imagine how much of cost it is going to be. Right? That's where these cloud companies are coming and saying, well, buddies, why do you do all of that? We have the data centers built already with servers, networking, storage, analytics, big data, monitoring, access control, machine learning, artificial intelligence, whatnot. What do you need? We have 100 plus different services in our portfolio, right? You don't pay a single penny initially. You don't pay anything initially. You pay a zero. You start use any combination of these services, any individual or combination of these services. And at the end of the month, based on your consumption, we will send you a bill. It's just like your power consumption. If you need a power at your house, well, we will not set up a thermal power generation station. It could be the water, or it could be thermal, I mean the coal burning or wastage burning or wind power. No, we will rent the power services from government companies, and based on our consumption, end of the month we will pay the bill. That's all. The similar model, they say you do not have to invest the huge amount of money initially. Instead, come and use our services and pay for what you actually use end of the month. That is eliminating huge, huge initial cost. Well, I'm not reading something from the book. Remember, guys, you put yourself into that situation and you'll understand, because today you are in a mindset to learn a new technology, and somebody is suggesting Azure, somebody is suggesting you DevOps, somebody is suggesting you something else, maybe, you know. But then you need to understand why. If I learn the technology, how long the demand will continue? How long will I have the long lasting career? What is the justification? Right? So you see, that's if there are such benefits, advantages, you know, tell me who will not go there. Venkat, I doubt maybe they have some restrictions. I can only have 2 servers created. I only have 10 servers created. Maybe servers of 1 CPU, 2 GB RAM. Don't you think such kind of rules and regulations going to be there? Well, they say you start with 0 servers and you can scale to thousands of servers. There is no restriction. You can create a server with 1 CPU, 0.5 GB of RAM, and you can scale up to 128 CPUs and 4 terabyte of RAM as of today, and it may increase in future. In between, there are many options given to you, from 1 CPU, 0.5 GB of RAM, 128 CPUs and 4 TB of RAM. Okay, so you have that scalability. There are no boundaries. In a traditional on-premises, let's say you purchase a laptop of 2 CPUs and 8 GB of RAM, you invest a lot of money into it, and you realize this configuration doesn't suit you and you need to go for maybe 4 CPUs and 16 GB of RAM. Do you think that you can easily change this without any loss? You have to sell this at a discounted rate. 20% less, 30% less, 40% less, 50, based on your urgency, the condition of a product. Even if you return it immediately to the shop, they are not going to take it. Okay, now, what is the option? If that is the case with your laptop, and imagine about the servers, right? But here in AWS or in Azure, in Google Cloud, in Oracle Cloud, you just can change the capacity, the size of it, in just a matter of minutes. That too, without losing a single penny. And then it increases your availability, because let's say if I have a mission critical application, what do I do is I have 2 CPUs, 8 gigs of RAM with a Windows server operating system installed on it. And then there is a possibility that this server may go down, right? And in fact, to talk about the high availability, we will start this at a component level. I have a single network interface card in a server. If that fails, so you bring another one, you configure the teaming. So if one fails, the other will automatically take care. And when it comes to the hard disks, you'll bring minimum of 2, you configure RAIDs. Right, RAID 1, 0, 1, 0, 5, different RAIDs. So they are configured in a team. If one fails, one hard disk fail, you have the other one to take care. And you'll bring minimum of 2 HBAs. You configure them in team. You have got multi-pothing and all of that stuff. If one fails, you have the other one to take care of the load of your storage traffic. That way, you have got 2 power supplies. You have got 2 fans. Possible number of components on your server to be redundant. But still, after doing all of it, what if the entire server fails? Your application is down. Have you ever seen Google saying that I have a server failure? Have you ever seen YouTube saying that I have a server failure? Facebook? If the free services are of that highly available, imagine your paid services, right? That's where, to deliver maximum uptime to your customers, you'll bring minimum of 2 servers, you will configure them in clustering. In the back end, what's happening? Your investment is doubled, as you have to bring 2 identical servers, 2 operating systems, 2 application licenses, right? But in the cloud, you have a standard SLA delivered to you, 4 nines of SLA. To achieve 4 nines on-premises, you have to create 2 servers minimum, put them into the load balancer. That too are highly available, I mean, that too are high-end servers. So you have that high availability by default in the cloud. Security, right? So, I mean, there is a wrong perception in IT today. Most of the times with the IT managers, because they are the decision makers, they feel if I have a server in my data center, assume this is your data center, and if I have servers, networking, storage, everything inside my data center, I feel that it is secure, right? But it is actually not, right? It really doesn't matter where the data or your servers are, but it matters because it is today, everything is connected to the internet. Your data center is connected to internet. The cloud data centers are also connected to internet. When things are connected to internet and the applications are being operated on the internet, it really doesn't matter where the physical location of the servers or application is, but it matters what kind of security policies, standards, compliances that you're running. Okay, you go to your IT manager today and you ask, like, sir, how many standards that we have for our data center? How many certifications and compliances that you follow? You will see, he may say, sir, we are ISO 9001 certified. That's all. There is nothing else. But in the cloud, you see, there are at least 50 different standards, certifications, and compliances that Azure, Microsoft, and the Google companies are following. Right? And they know what actually happening in IT, so they can immediately take actions. They can keep their environment always up to date with respect to the security things. This is not something that I'm verbally telling you to convince the companies and you, but this is something documented. And when we make some progress into the classes, I can show you what specific certifications and standards and compliances that the providers are having. Right? And then the mobility. You go anywhere in the world, you have the servers connected. It's all internet-based. Not necessarily you have to connect all your servers to the internet, but yes, there are again security things coming into the picture, like you have your own router, you have your own firewalls, you've got your own ports and protocols and the source IP addresses to allow. Well, I mean, you have that security things in place, but I'm just telling you, the data center is mobile, that it can be moved. Well, let's say today you are in Azure, you wanted to move to AWS, possible. Google, possible. Oracle, possible. Even to on-premises, possible, right? So there is no vendor locking thing in the cloud. It's mobile, you can move them, you can move servers anywhere, you can connect them from anywhere. All you need is an internet connectivity and a VPN client installed on it. Now tell me, who will not go to the cloud? It eliminates your capital expense. It reduces a lot of operating expense. You have the great scalability. There is no boundary. You can do both scale up and scale out. Huge high availability, 4 nines of availability, day one delivered to you. And you can also make 5 nines, 6 nines, all nines, 10 nines by combining different services. Right? And you have security, mobility. Right? It's wonderful. But then who is driving the change, Venkat? Who is bringing all these features into the industry? Why are they doing? Is that change good or bad for us? Right? Well, big companies like Microsoft, like Amazon, like Google, Oracle, Alibaba, all these companies are driving this change. Okay. So, as these companies are driving the change, saying, hey, you come to us, we will give you a server for 1 rupee. And Amazon says, hey, you come to us, I'll give you a server for 80 paisa. Google says 70 paisa, Oracle says 60, and it's a circle. And Azure says, we will give it to you 50 paisa. So there is such kind of a healthy competition in the market. And you know the other factor, I'm not sure if you guys follow the news, 2017, in the month of August or September, the CEO of Amazon company, Andy Jassy, have become the world's richest person for a while and dropped down to the second place now. We all knew for how many years and decades that Microsoft is in the IT industry and how many dozens or hundreds of products they have in their portfolio. In spite of Microsoft making efforts for these many years in different areas, Amazon in the industry just for 5 years or less than that, right? They have generated revenue many times bigger than Microsoft. It is because industry that they have selected, the cloud business, is fetching them the huge profit levels. So from Amazon's the overall profit levels, Amazon Kindle, the bookshop, Amazon e-commerce site, and the cloud, 85 or 90% of the profit is actually coming from the cloud services. Okay, that's where the other companies realized the fact. So in spite of they give us many times the discounts, still they have the huge profits. So they are putting the same profits into the investment to bring out more and more features, to develop more features. That's where it's making a better business case to the customers, the companies, like all these companies. And they are, you know, they are making a better business case. Hey, when I'm getting this service in the cloud for a better price, better security, better availability, scalability, durability, management overhead, then why would I do it on premises? Maintenance activities, patches, updates, blah, 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 spending the weekends at office, you know, spending the nights on the troubleshooting an issue, right? That's where these companies are driving the change, saying we have XYZ things in our portfolio, we are offering at a less price, right? Now, what should we do? We can't do anything but to learn one that is in demand, right? So to understand the cloud or to understand the Azure, because now, of course, today we are talking about the Azure. So obviously I have to drive you through the Azure concepts. So Azure is a cloud computing service created by Microsoft for building, deploying, and managing applications and services through the global network of Microsoft managed data centers. It is not just one data center that they have, not just two data centers that they have. They have globally more than 50 data centers. That too, not just in one location, right? So all those data centers are being managed by Microsoft. We, as the customers, can just we or the customers just have to deploy our applications and then start using the cloud services, right? So Microsoft is a cloud computing Azure is a cloud computing service created by Microsoft. And you know what, I always believe learning technology, not the product. Because if you know driving a Honda car, do you think driving a Maruti car is different? No, maybe a little bit of controls here and there, but it's going to be the same gearbox, same clutch, same accelerator, same brake, same steering, same margins. A little bit of change in look and feel of a car, the comfort of a car, right? Similarly, when you say infrastructure as a service delivery model, infrastructure as a service delivery model. Well, I'll give you these inputs. Like there are two other delivery models also, but infrastructure as a service delivery model, it is the same that Azure is doing. It is the same that AWS is doing. It is the same that Oracle is doing. Same rest everybody can do. Okay. So by replacing Azure, if you put AWS here, AWS is a cloud computing service created by Amazon for building, deploying, and managing applications and services through a global network of AWS managed data centers. You see that now if you have learned AWS as well, right? And it provides software as a service, platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, and supports many different programming languages, tools, and frameworks, including both Microsoft-specific and third-party softwares. That means it supports both .NET, Python, PHP, Node.js, everything. Even AWS does the same, Google does the same. They have offerings into platform as a service, software as a service, infrastructure as a service, and they support all industry standard programming languages, including .NET and the other programming languages to support, I mean, to develop and to host the applications, right? I mean, I'm just giving you an idea that you need a trainer who can teach you the technology, not a product. It's not like you get into the portal, say right click here, left click here, you have a virtual machine created. That's fine, buddy. I can get that knowledge looking at a manual also, even the YouTube videos. you do a right click here, left click here, I have the machine running, but you need to understand the concepts of it, right? So well, Azure, like I said, is having more than 100 services in their portfolio today. 38 is an old number. They have more than 50 data centers today. And all those 50 data centers are having the building blocks of the data centers. That is compute, storage, networking, monitoring, and access control. For any data center to build, these are the building blocks. You've got the physical servers and operating system, virtualization layer. You've got the storage. You've got the networking in place. On top of that, they have designed like many services. Today, they have got 100 plus services in 50 plus different data centers. Okay. So, of course, I agree that I'm not going in detail into the Azure things, but I'm just helping you understand what this cloud computing is always. But yes, now let me take you to the Azure learning. Right. One of the frequently asked question is, Venkat, I am new to this, or I'm coming from a different platform, a different work profile. I'm non-IT, maybe a mechanical engineer, maybe a HR, maybe a developer, maybe a storage guy, maybe a network guy, OS, virtualization, or maybe into the different other things, databases, right? And I wanted to learn Azure, right? Can I directly jump in here and learn Azure, or are there any prerequisites that I need to understand? Yes, there are something, definitely the basics, because cloud is something not a starting point. There are some basics that you need to learn. The basics are the building blocks of the data center. Building blocks of the data center. That is, like, you need to know the server hardware. You need to know the server operating system. You need to know the networking. You need to know the storage and backup and disaster recovery. The basics, that means, what is an SLA? What is a backup? What is a backup window? What is a differential backup, full backup, incremental backup? What is a hard disk? What is a RAID level? What is a protocol like SAN, NAS, ISCSI? What is a IP address? What is a gateway? What is a switch, a router, firewall, right? A subnet. And then what is a Windows operating system, a Linux operating system? How do I create the users? How do I install operating system at least? Then how do I install the application, change the permissions, create a user, control the access? What is a hardware? What is a server at least and the laptop? What are the components of a server? How they function? Basics of it. Because when you go to the cloud, you know that you have a virtual machine in Azure cloud. The same is called as EC2 in AWS cloud. Same is called as GCE, Google Compute Engine in Google cloud. The same is called as virtual machine Oracle cloud. The names are different. End of the day, it is a virtual machine or a virtual server. So what is a virtual server? Right? Virtual server is a software computer or a software server. So what is the server? Server is a special purpose designed. It's a special purpose hardware designed to carry the heavy duty workloads. It will have hot add, highly available redundant components, right? And it is just a one liner definition, but there is a lot that you need to understand. What are the components of a server? CPU, network interface card, hard disk, right? And memory modules. What is a CPU? How it works, how the network interface card works, how a hard disk work, and how a memory module work. Because if you don't know this and you cannot understand this virtual machine concept, of course you can. What the trainers can teach you is Azure virtual machine is an infrastructure as a service offering where you can create virtual machines with the different operating system combinations and virtual machines with the different hardware configurations. If you have a database, you have to select a machine that is with high CPU memory. If you have a web application, you have to configure a machine with high memory. If you have an application server, you have to configure a machine with high CPU. But why? Why? Why people in South India are spicy food? Why people in North India like sweet food? If you feeding them the other way, if you give us too spicy food to North India, I mean, this is not to go to a personal level discussion, but I'm just telling you, help you understand the topic in a better way. If you start feed them the other way, what happens? They don't like and they start not eating the food after 10 days, after 1 month, you will see the negative results. The same way, if I have a database and if you are giving more of a network bandwidth, less CPU, less memory, less storage, what happens? You will see the performance degradation. Why a database needs more of a compute and memory, or more of a storage IO? Right? At least what the CPU is doing in the first place. What is this core? What is this socket? Hyper-threading, multi-threading, right? So that's the fundamental knowledge that you need to know. That I'll be teaching here in all the areas. There are six topics: server hardware, OS, networking, storage, virtualization fundamentals, and the cloud computing fundamentals. From the six topics, there are 12 hours of recorded videos that I'll be sharing with you. 12 hours of recorded videos. And 533 is an old story. Let me take you to the Microsoft official page. These are all the different certifications that Microsoft has to offer. Okay, so we are at this 533. That's where the cloud Azure Administrator certification comes in. Sorry, we are at 535. So it was costing some $165, you see. Okay, skills. It was actually introduced in year 2014. Let me see, 2014. So this is about the cancellation policy. It is actually introduced about 4 or 5 years back. So what they've done is Microsoft is making significant changes to the certification. To learn more, see the blog post. Unfortunately, that blog post is no longer available. Oh, well, good. Then at least we have this post available. Let me put that in chat window. Nav. Microsoft. So as a result, the exam 533 will be replaced with two new exams that will cover the Azure Administrator job roles more extensively than the current one is doing. To support these changes, they are retiring 533, 31st December 2018. So this month, the 31st, the exam will no longer be available after 31st. So they have added two more certifications, AZ-100, AZ-101. So in my training, I'll be teaching you both AZ-100 and AZ-101. So this is basically, let me open this. If you see, it says Azure Web Applications, Azure Resources and Virtual Machines, Storage, Networking, ARM, that is automation of the resources, Site Recovery, Azure operational benefits like using PowerShell and the other monitoring and the operational tools, identities. What they have done here, they have not done anything special about this. They're also talking about the same resources, managing the storage, virtual machines, network and identities. The same thing that we had in 533. Okay. And then in 101, it is about integration and security. So evaluate and perform server migration to Azure. This is about the migrations. Implement and manage applications. This is about the web applications. Implement in the networking and identities. Right? So it is the same that was part of 533. They've just streamlined it a little bit. So some 2019, right? It's better that you go for AZ-100 and AZ-101. Okay? So in our training program that I'll be covering both 100 and 101 along with the basics that you need to know to get started with the cloud computing. Venkat, what do you teach us in 100 and 101? Well, like I said, I work with authorized training companies to deliver the corporate trainings. So I don't maintain separate course content and the slides or the presentations or the material for two different training programs. Whatever the content that I deliver to the official trainings, that is pretty much whatever is mentioned by Microsoft in their official website will be covered in our training program. No deviations, no less, no more. Of course, there will be more, but no less. All right. Ah, Venkat, we have attended many trainings like this in the past. We have seen many things like when we sit in the class, things are fancy. We feel like we have learned everything. But when we face the interviews, things are different. Nobody follow the traffic rules. But when you see them in book, it's well written. Right? Well, my answer to this is, along with the topics that are mentioned in the official blueprint, we will also be discussing the real-time scenarios. Okay. For example, if we have to practice a load balancer topic, let's say, I will not just say a load balancer is a device that can balance the load or it distributes the load across the backend servers, but we will create two servers in two different locations. We will create a load balancer. We will publish an application on the internet so that you all, no matter where you sit, you all can access that application, can see if the load is actually being distributed or not. And to simulate a failure, I mean, to see if what if a server fails, will be failing a server, then we will see traffic, how it is redirected to the only available server. After a while, we'll bring back the failed server. We will see how the traffic is failed over and failed back. The same goes for every single service that we're going to discuss. A good part in the cloud is, for example, if you're learning a database, if you're learning Exchange, if you're learning ERP tools, you cannot simulate the lab. Right, you cannot create a lab environment as is your production environment is. But yes, in the cloud you can do it. It is going to be the same graphical user interface, the same features, same services in your lab environment and in your production environment. So easily after completing this training, I have many students in different areas, in Azure, in AWS, in Google Cloud, in DevOps, have completed the trainings, keeping 2 to 4 years of experience, have got the jobs and working today. So our training is with real-time scenarios. And we'll be talking about the architecture best practices. Like I mentioned, if you have a database, why should we have more of a memory and IO? If I have a web server, why should I have more of compute? Or maybe more of a memory? If I have an application server, why should I need more of a compute? Right, so I'll be giving you that best practices for all the services so that you just make a note of it, and then you will be talking about the same in your interview, and we'll talk about the reference architectures as well. That means, how can we design a media streaming application? How can we design maybe analytics application, maybe a e-commerce application, maybe a big data Hadoop clusters kind of thing, right? Then of course, I'll be giving you certification questions. In fact, I have a pass guarantee program. So once you complete my training program, you will be 200% able to clear 101.1. Earlier, I have this for 533, and now I'll continue that 101.1. You will have 200% pass guarantee. I'll give you some dump files. It is not just that I'm giving you a wrong practice of allowing you to practice the dumps, but then it is helping you understand how the question's gonna come in your exam. And on top of that, you have my explanation, the theoretical explanation, labs, and everything, right? And of course, it's not like maybe at the end of the training, a day or 2 days that I'll dedicate to dump some interview questions on you. But every day I'll be highlighting a topic. I'll be highlighting the scenarios. Well, this can come in an interview and the question may be asked like this. And you're expected to answer this way. That way I'll be highlighting the scenarios about the interview questions as well. And on top of it, your practice is necessary. Pass guarantee doesn't mean that you attend this training, go to exam without any practice, reading material, you'll pass the exam. It's not that way, right? It means when you attend this training, follow all the classes, practice all the labs, read through all the material that I'm going to share you, and practice all the questions that I'm going to give you, and then your pass is guaranteed. Without your efforts, you know that I cannot do anything. Right? Well, then, one last thing that I wanted to highlight is, we give you a high quality training, okay? Because I was working until a couple of years back. Now I'm into full-time trainings and consultation. So one of the primary reason that I've stepped into the trainings is because, one, it's my passion. Two, I see like a lot of training companies. It's not to point out somebody and to maybe do some business, but we people are in need of learning something new, something that can get us a job. And that has become a business somehow. Right. So to help the maximum possible number of people, I've started this company, Kurela Cognitive Private Limited, where we give a very high quality training. You can ask me a question, Venkat, the picture is of a low quality and you're talking about high quality trainings, right? Yes, you will witness the results at the end of the training. I put a low quality photo in there is because nobody says that we are going to give you a low quality training. Nobody is going to say that we will only read through the slides. We will not give you explanation. Nobody is going to tell you we are not going to practice you any labs. Nobody is going to tell you we will not give you intro questions. Everybody says the same. It's you who can see the difference, right? It's you who can interact with the trainer, understand if he's really a technical guy, if you really have that experience, right? Then it's you who can take the decision. But price, that's fine. You keep it aside because 18 years of full-time education, 2-3 years of struggle in the market, maybe 4-5 years of real-time experience into a technology that is no longer in demand, a technology that is putting us on a rotational shift, no hike at the end of the year. You have went through all the struggles, and to learn a technology that is in demand from a quality trainer, with all the assurance and guarantees, we have to compromise with the price. I will definitely say my price is a little higher, but definitely not at a level that you guys cannot reach. But price, keep it aside. You see the content, see the classes, then all I can say, thank you. Right? So thanks for listening to me, and any questions, guys?
Yeah, Venkat, this is Vignesh.
Yes, Vignesh.
Yeah. Suppose if I am completed the old one, 533, mm-hmm. In future it is valid or not?
533, it is not. Then you have to take this 102.
Okay.
So if you have taken this exam, you wanted to transit to the new Azure Administration Certification, you have to take this 102.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. And that's the reason you see the price is a little low compared to the other two.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Any other questions?
One more question. I am now today, if you are starting that sessions, sometimes I am not able to attend the session due to some meetings and all. That time, how can I manage that one?
For the missed classes, I'll be providing you the recorded videos of the classes.
Okay.
So if you happen to miss a class, you just let me know on demand. I'll get you the recorded copy of it.
Okay.
And of course, you have the student manuals that are the PDF documents for every single topic that we are discussing. You have the lab guides for every topic that we'll be practicing. You have some 400 questions, the dump file that I'll be giving it to you. And you have a retake policy with which you will be able to attend the course second time free of cost. So, and you will be interacting with the trainer directly to me. So you can come to our office that is in KPHP Road number 1, or you can join online like how you've joined today. So yeah, it is always there.
Okay.
Any other questions, guys?
Yeah, Venkat, this is Srikant. So when you're going to start the class, daily classes?
So it will continue from tomorrow. Tomorrow comes about. I'm sorry, I put you guys on mute because there is some background noise. So it will start from tomorrow. It will continue from tomorrow. Normally, the schedule is like this. It will be from Monday to Friday, 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m., 1.5 hour of class. So classes will continue from tomorrow. Tomorrow, the topic is going to be cloud computing fundamentals to help you people understand cloud as a technology, right? So, and then tomorrow is Friday, and from Monday, we will be getting into the Azure level discussions. Overall, it is a 40 hours of training. It takes a month, 1 month of time to complete the course. But this time, I think this month we have some Christmas. That is on 24th and 25th of this month, a new year. So it will be a mutual understanding on which days we take a leave and how we plan our schedule. But otherwise, it is between Monday to Friday. It takes 1 month of time and it will be 40 hours. And in addition to that, there is 12 hours of recorded videos into those fundamentals I'm talking about. There are also, of course, the PDF documents available.
I will get my submission ready.
Guys, your voice is not clear.
I will get my submission ready. If possible, can you please start?
9 o'clock. That I'll have to check with the others in the group actually.
Yeah, the same thing. I already posted a message in the group chat also in WhatsApp. If anybody has a question, come back so that accordingly you can be planned to start the class.
Definitely. Today my marketing team is going to call up everybody. So we'll check if it is visible with the others. If yes, sorry. Our marketing team will check with the others if it is feasible to start at 9 o'clock. If our friends are ready, then I have no issues to start it at 9 o'clock. But then cannot guarantee you right now.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other questions? Well, it could be questions in general as well. So not necessary always about Azure. Maybe if you have something in your mind to take a career decision and you wanted to have that discussed here, well, you're welcome.
Yeah, Venkat, I am a CRM developer. It is useful for this Azure course because in the development perspective, what we need to learn are entirely, it will be very useful in future. Would you explain?
Sure, Vignesh. So you being a CRM developer in the sense like what programming you use?
C sharp we are using.
Okay. Okay. C#.NET. Yeah. Well, when it comes to the cloud, there are two tracks of learning to start with. One is into the development side. The other is into the administration side. And then in next level, you have something into security and compliance and auditing. And then you've got into the advanced networking, you've got into the databases and analytics, you've got into the machine learning, artificial. They are like the second level. To start with, only two tracks, development and administration. So okay. To get into the development side, you already must be a developer having extensive experience into one of the programming languages. It could be Java, .NET, Python, PHP, Node.js, one of it. So that using the Azure cloud services, you will be developing the code, you'll be saving that code into the repositories. They have automated backup, version control things. You'll compile in there, you'll fix if there are any issues, and you'll publish the applications into the Azure cloud. For you, there is a program called Azure Certified Developer. I think there is 102, certification number 102.
Okay.
Sorry, 200. Yeah, Azure Developer Core Services.
Okay.
Okay. There is also 2.1 that is also into the developer role, but earlier it was 5.32 developing Microsoft Azure solutions. But okay. Here also, if you see, what you are being taught is you see, here also it says creating and managing resources of virtual machines, storage, networking, implementing the mobile and web applications. Okay.
Okay.
So if you have to make API calls to the Azure virtual machines or storage or to the networking and the other services, identity or applications, and if you don't know what is that virtual machine, the functionality of it, what API calls would you make to it?
Yeah.
Right. So even for developers, I would advise you to go through this 533 or AZ100, AZ101, which are the current certifications. But otherwise, yes, developers, you already must be a developer, then take the certified developer training program. And those who wanted to get into the administrator, like I said, you need to know those basics that I mentioned, right? Server hardware, networking, storage, all of that. Once you have that basic knowledge, you can get into 533 or this AZ100 101.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah. But then, you see, when you get into the developer again, let's say if there are 100 opportunities, those 100 opportunities are split by the programming language. Not everybody uses Java, not everybody uses .NET, not everybody uses Python, PHP. So 100 opportunities, let's say 10 are only for Java guys, 10 the .NET, 10 Python, 10 PHP. So that way, the total number of opportunities are split into different programming languages. But if there are 100 opportunities for administrators, there's no such profile splitting kind of thing. All 100 for administrators only.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
That pre-recorded videos, 10 records, fundamental videos, once we are completed that one, then only we are starting our sessions, or that is not mingled with them. How we'll do that one?
So in fact, if you look at my message in the WhatsApp group also a couple of days back, if you decide to take this course, right, it is always good that you have that basics knowledge before we start our technical classes. Technical classes. That means tomorrow it will be cloud computing fundamentals. It's more of a theory. That's fine. And on Monday, it will be introduction to Azure. Tuesday, it is going to be getting started with Azure. So until this, it's fine. But on Wednesday, when we start Azure virtual machine theoretical class, by then you are expected to know the server hardware knowledge.
Okay.
So by then you must have watched that first video, server hardware. And then Wednesday we'll be doing the labs of virtual machine. And Thursday, when we start the storage topics, Azure storage topic, you are expected to watch. There are two videos in the storage fundamentals. So you're expected to watch those two videos.
Okay.
And storage classes will take 2 days. And then maybe by following Monday, when we start the Azure networking classes, you are expected to watch two networking videos that you have in fundamentals. So that's how it is.
Okay. 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 Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions, guys?
Venkat, Dura here. Being an Azure admin, so what are the roles and responsibilities we need to take care of that in real-time scenarios?
Well, like you mentioned, you are already an admin, so all administrative activities have to be taken care of.
Sorry, I'm not an admin, so I'm just asking, like, if you become an Azure admin, so what are the roles and responsibilities?
Yeah, so always, like, being an admin, let's say if you're a server admin, forget about the cloud, right? If you're just a server admin, what you will be taking care of? If there is a new provisioning, right, you will create a server. If there is any patches, you'll be doing it. If there is any configuration changes, you'll be doing it. If there is any performance issue, you'll be troubleshooting it. If there is in a resource bump up that customer is asking for more resources, you'll be doing that configuration change. You'll be provisioning the access on it. The similar roles will be in the cloud, but when you are a server admin, your roles are limited to the server only. When you are a virtualization admin, your roles are maybe you have to work on the networking area, virtual network. You have to work in the virtual storage area, the monitoring as well. When you become a cloud administrator, right, along with these, you will also be working at IAM, Identity and Access Management, so that you decide if access need to be provisioned to somebody, or restricted access, full access, what it is. You'll be configuring the backups, you'll be configuring the replications. So you'll be maybe generating the reports based on the availability or based on the utilization and a couple of other factors. So that way, all your regular administrator roles plus all your administration roles plus the cloud services, whatever comes into your bucket. But again, in the real time, the job profiles are not yet streamlined. Okay, that means some organizations, when you say cloud admin, they allow you to do everything, and some organizations, they will only allow you to work with virtual machines only, maybe a little bit of into the storage only. So that way, the job profile may depends from organization to organization, what is the level of scope given to you. But in general, when you say Azure administrator or AWS administrator, it includes your server related, network related, storage related, monitoring related, access related, load balancers, and little bit of into the database also. All those activities have to be performed. Did I answer your question, Dora?
Yes, Venkat. Yeah.
Thank you.
One more general question.
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, one more general question. Like, how the career opportunities in Azure admin like be when we compare to other cloud technologies or other platforms?
Yeah, for sure, there are two big players in the cloud today. It's Azure and AWS. They are the big players. Google is trying to come into the industry, but it's a tough time for them. And then Oracle is also trying to make, but then they're doing good job in CRM area, but not in the infrastructure as a service delivery model. When it comes to Azure and AWS, it's purely a choice, right? If I ask you, Samsung and Sony, it's a choice. Similarly, organizations are making choice to opt to Azure, to opt to AWS. But then Microsoft is winning the market as they already have the Microsoft solutions in the industry. So they are giving, in the name of hybrid licensing model, they are giving huge benefits when it comes to the pricing of the cloud platform. So of late, if you see that many customers are going to the Azure, and also at the same level, Amazon is also winning the market. But in Amazon Cloud, I think there are already good number of profiles in the industry that too many people have certified, trained, and looking for the jobs. The interviews are at a intermediate level. I mean, they will not ask you basic, they will not ask you too advanced, but interviews are at intermediate level. But for Azure, it's a less skill set. To be honest, you know, I also work as a consultant for the companies to hire the individuals. At least every week, I'll be taking some 20 interviews at least. So they'll ask me to evaluate the profiles. So for Azure, we have very less skill set in the industry today. Maybe you can take that as an opportunity. Even those who are training people on Azure, I'm sorry to say this, but yes, have a limited knowledge, right? So maybe you see that as an opportunity, and that too, that Microsoft is changing the certifications from 533 to 101 and 100. You know, that is also an added advantage. You know, maybe I feel that this is the right time to get into Azure, get yourself certified, look, get ready for February, March, April season. Maybe that's what I can say. But don't think that I'm doing some marketing job here for Azure, but I am also a trainer into AWS. So I'm okay even if you jump into that bucket.
Thank you. You got it.
Thank you. Yeah. So any other questions?
Yeah, Venkat, this is Srikant. Yes, comparing with Azure Architect and Azure Admin, So how the job profiles are changing? Even Architect also can do the admin activities and development activities. So What is the scope of getting the job in the industry as a Azure Admin?
I think Azure admin or the cloud admin or the normal profiles, you'll have more opportunities today, you see. And for architect level, in my experience, what I've seen is for designing and implementation, which is a one-time task, mid-level companies and companies who do not have a skill set is outsourcing that work or asking Microsoft or AWS to do that initial work, design, implement. And then for support and the ongoing activities is where they are hiring the administrators. Now, the cloud architect that you're talking about, even to reach to that level, you must have to complete this entry level certifications, that is 101. Once you complete them, then only you'll be able to take the advanced level certification, that is architecting on Azure cloud. Okay. And the other thing is, like, you cannot hire an architect and ask him to you cannot put him into a rotational shift and say you take care of the virtual machine creation, you monitor the servers. We certainly cannot do that. Definitely the architect level role is definitely at a high level, and he will definitely not be monitoring and doing the daily BAU stuff. So today, I mean, very less number of architects available. The real architects are available in the industry. It's a short of skill set. And at the same time, companies have find the supplement, like asking the providers to implement it or maybe outsourcing the initial implementations. Okay, so you really cannot see a competition between the admin and the architect.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you. All right. So thanks a lot for being part of this session. I will be anyway sending this recorded video to everybody in the group. And tomorrow also it is the same meeting invitation, same time. Feel free to extend this invitation to your friends, colleagues, or if you feel this is informative to anybody. Right. And then we'll catch you up.
Yeah, Venkat, last question. One is the last question. So as part of Azure admin or any other job roles, do we need to learn PowerShell as well? Is it going to be play any key role like scripting languages?
Definitely, PowerShell is the future. I don't say PowerShell is the future, but yes, scripting or automation is the future. So in that process, Microsoft, you know how importance that Microsoft gives for PowerShell in all their products, not just in Azure, but any other product that you take, right? So in Azure also, they have a importance, and then it's good that you learn Azure PowerShell in order to control any service programmatically. But one change in Azure is instead of PowerShell, I mean, of course, along with PowerShell, they have one more CLI option called Azure CLI. Okay, Azure CLI is a unified command line interface that can be, I mean, unified command line utility that can be installed in Linux machines, Mac machines, and also on Microsoft machines. This is the first ever Microsoft CLI released that can be installed on non-Microsoft operating systems. So the idea is to bring a unified programming language. Okay, so the syntax of these commands will not change when you execute them in Windows operating system, you execute them in Linux, you execute them in Mac. So going forward, what I feel is maybe they wanted to have a standard programming interface like how the other competitors are having, like AWS CLI. The commands are standard. You can execute the same commands on Microsoft machine clients or Linux clients and Apple clients. So they, with respect to Azure only, they may give more importance to the Azure CLI than Power CLI or PowerShell. But currently, both are given, you know, equal importance. In fact, PowerShell is widely being used because the industry is used to it, and we have all administrators familiar with the PowerShell commands and the scripting. So did I answer your question?
Yeah, okay. Understood, got the point.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, thank you. Catch you tomorrow. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.